Hey, hey, this is Alex Sklonick.
This is Chris Tomato Harfenist.
And we're back here at Tomato's House of Rock in New York City to wrap up our season of Louder Education.
And we're so excited, couldn't be more excited to have this gentleman in our studios, in our presence, with our kids.
It's pretty awesome. yeah, thanks to everybody watching so far. And just to wrap it up, we have something really cool. He is a slimy, foul-mouthed, politically incorrect monster.
Monster.
Literally, from another planet. He goes by the name of Oderus Urungus. It's going to be great. So
fucking Gwar.
Gwar.
I personally couldn't be more excited about having this guest here today.
I mean, this guest is more than a musician. He's an institution.
Yeah.
He's all over the media to this day. You'll see him on everything from Fox News, making weird, bizarre appearances, to Joan Rivers.
Jerry Springer.
And, of course, he's best known as the frontman of Gwar. That... We've been seeing for how many years now?
Since I was their age.
Wow.
I have my Gwar. I used to have Gwar Timberlands that I would only wear to Gwar shows because my calendar was all about when Gwar was coming to town next, so I can get in that pit and get bloody and get,
and get slimed.
Get slimed and insane and brown and anything they would throw at me.
So I don't think this has ever been done. Oderus in front of a bunch of kids.
Yeah.
Oderus, you're running!
I just want to fall over into you and roll around.
You get the idea.
It's like a student carpet. It's like Alex!
Hey, Oderus.
How's it going, buddy?
Good to see you.
I made a savage love to you, but I'm afraid this would fall off.
Yeah, are you okay there?
I'm fine. Good to see you, my friend. Why one of the most respected metal guitar players ever would want to sully his career by hanging out with the likes of me, something I don't understand, but he does it over and over again.
It keeps happening, Thank you for...
Well, it's great to be here. Thank you for having me. I just want to... Let's all hang out.
The future.
What's this guy doing here? You don't look
What are you talking... It's the future of metal. That's what we're trying to say.
I think he might look more metal than anybody else in here.
Exactly.
In a way, right.
He's going to play Let Us Slay with you later.
Right.
Fucking A. Well,
in that outfit.
Let me tell you, that outfit slays.
You're so pretty. What do you mean?
Yeah, you're beautiful.
I'm so pretty and witty and gay in this city. I can't even hardly believe that I'm here today. See that little girl in that mirror? Who could that attractive girl be? Such a pretty face, such a pretty neck, such a fuck it up.
See, these are the talents that people don't know about.
I got one more.
Cabaret,
Cabaret, yeah. Joel Grey. Liza Minnelli. I mean, I wonder if kids really were raised with a lot of those classic stars that we had. Because, you had the classic era of Hollywood with Elizabeth Taylor and, Cary Grant. And every actor back then was an amazing, just an icon, a god, really. And now you have these, I don't know what you would call the leading men of today. They're so bad that one of the biggest ones of them can die of a drug overdose, not only 2 years ago. That what's his name died? Heath Ledger died.
Yeah.
Right.
Anyone give a damn? They were just like, on to the next one. We've still got Tom Cruise.
Yeah.
I thought that was what really sad and alarmingly disgusting. And it's also something that happens to musicians a lot. And I really brought this down.
And now Tom Cruise is being cast as
a
hard rock
Tom
musician.
Tom Cruise would die of a fucking overdose. and Lindsay Lohan is playing Elizabeth Taylor.
Right.
I would say people a lot of times are like, oh, what would you compare your own band to? And of all the bands that are out there, obviously you've got to say Kiss, because they came before us.
Who had good music too.
And their music was great, if you're into four chords over and over and over.
That's what you do with them.
But you know what? You can make great music with four. You can make great music with one fucking chord.
Right.
But I've always said the greatest songs were the songs that were written the fastest.
Right.
The ones that just came out like a greasy shit. It's like, whoa, that was good. Tell me if I'm talking too much, because I'm really having a blast right now.
No, talk away. This is what we want to hear about. Like, Gwar, the music and the show.
Horror Obviously, of Yig. That's the best.
I'll tell you about Horror of Yig was one of, like, the first... You know, the first record we put out was Hello. We put that out in 1988. And we, at the time, you know, we were just de-thawed. We were, you know, babes in the woods. We saw American culture and we were just like, what the hell is that? We learned about American culture at the end of a crack pipe while watching MTV. And I wouldn't force that on anybody. But our own superior intellects took over after a while. We were able to see that this was just a ploy from our managers, Lee Z.P. Martini.
Oh, yeah.
And I developed my own understanding of your planet. And considering I possess a godlike intelligence, now I know the score backwards and forwards. When we were starting our first record, Hello, in 1988, pretty much back then, we didn't have this interweb thing. Could you imagine what your lives would be like if you didn't have the internet? You didn't have it. It just didn't exist. That's what it was like for us. We had rotary phones.
Yeah.
Can you imagine that? We had this device where you put your finger in a hole and go, and then you would have to do that. What? 7 times!
Yeah.
10.
With a business.
10 if it was a long distance call! No! I got 11 because you had to add a 1.
Gotcha. With a busy signal.
Yeah. Told you it was godlike. What?
With a busy signal.
With a bit.
Emergency breakthrough.
I love that! Where's a busy signal?
I know,
why?
Bring that back!
Bring that back! I don't know if you've ever heard a legend. Of a man that went by the name of El Duce and his band. Yeah.
You guys know about that?
Yeah.
Oh my God.
You guys know the Mentors?
Wow,
we did Jerry Springer.
Oh, the infamous
that
episode.
Was when we were on Springer with El, we'd already known him about 4 or 5 years. But it was really because of him. He played with us. And he went around the rest of the country on tour telling everybody about this insane band from Antarctica. And, on his word, people booked our entire first tour. And one of the people that saw us was a dirty little hippie from New York City who went by the name of Kramer. And he had a label called Shimmy Disc. Yeah. And he worked with some artists like Ann Magnuson that you might be familiar with. She went to Hollywood to become a big star. Didn't quite make it, but I think I see her in a commercial every now and then. Right. I'm like, I know you! And she had a band called Vulcan Death Grip. Well, anyway, we put that first record out, and lo and behold, we had no idea, but all these people from metal. I mean, we never said to ourselves, we're going to be a metal band. We just made the noise. We played the songs that we wanted to hear, you know, ourselves. And we never did Gwar for any other reason than to amuse ourselves. We were stuck in Richmond, Virginia until El Duce told the world about how sick we were. And this little hippie in New York who ran Shimmy Disc Records called me up one day. I'd never even been to New York before. And he said, come to New York and record an album with us. And that's what we did. And, all of a sudden, Brian Slagle from Metal Blade Records was blowing
Great guy. Yeah.
Brian Slagle, and we were just like, you know, Brian, we love you, and we love the way that you take us out to eat every time that we see you. But we really felt, since people paid attention to our first record, that our second record had to be a real statement. And that's what Horror, to go all the way back to where we were about 10 minutes ago, that's what Horror of Yig was. We made that song to show people that we were serious.
That's a killer.
We laid down some heavy fucking rock, and we didn't care about costumes or shows. The first thing that was important about this band was being a band. And that's why Al Jurgensen produced that track on that record. We would have had him produce probably every track, except we couldn't afford him. But he did produce that one, and he wasn't damn expensive. Those producers are expensive.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
The thing that's great about now is, like, you know, ask you guys something. Do you ever read a review for a record where they go, oh, this band is the greats of blah, 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 but the bass guitar wasn't loud enough? You know, it's like, I never read reviews like that, but that's what bands fight over in the studio. My bass guitar isn't loud enough. My lead isn't loud enough. Believe me, that's not what people are listening to.
Right.
So if any of you guys are in bands that are in the studio, don't waste time on that shit. You gotta have soul and fire and have those two things first. And if you've got that, I don't care if you've only got a half of a day to be in the studio, you'll lay down those tracks and they'll rule. It's all about performance And it's all about believing in what you do.
Yeah.
And, you know, if you can do that, you got a hit. You can sit there and kerfuffle around all day with the levels and the notes and the this and the that. Well, I guess the notes are kind of important.
Yeah. And the look is important, too. Yeah.
You know what? I this is a fun thing, but what I feel like I'm monopolizing the conversation too much. I look at all you kids, and I know you've got 1,000 questions. I'd just like to hear from you guys.
There's a rumor that the reason Gwar rocks the huge outfits is because it was originally for a movie called Scumdogs of the Universe.
You've got it exactly correct. Slaves of Gwar. We're all living in an abandoned milk bottling factory that was built in the 1800s. Has to this day.
Typical band story.
Yeah typical.
How many people were there?
Over 40. There were a lot of people. Well, see, hippies had taken it over in the 70s.
Okay.
Wow. So it had already had a decade for weirdos to live in there. And the way that you lived in there is that you go in there, you go there to a party, and you find out, you talk to Russell. Russell was like the head hippie. And he rented space for 25 cents a month per square foot. And work that out for yourself how cheap that is. And people would literally, it was a gigantic manufacturing facility that had been denuded of all the industrial equipment inside of it. So it was nothing but cavernous shop halls. So people would empty blocks of space and then build structures in these that they would live in. Or in the case of Hunter Jackson, the artist, Gwar slave, that I will give all credit to Gwar too, had built this incredible set of the inside of an alien warship for a movie he was planning on making called Scumdogs of the Universe. And there was these costumes that he was building as well. I was practicing down the hall with my band, Death Diggy, my human slave.
My human
slave, Dave Brocky.
Dave Brocky,
Yeah. He takes credit for all the shit I did. Yeah. So I'd wander in there after we were done, and we would be practicing for my band, Death Piggy, which was a little crappy three-piece hardcore band, and it was horrible. I probably knocked years off of my life because when we practiced, dust would fall down from the ceiling, and we later found out it was asbestos. But after practice, I'd stumble down into Hunter's workshop, and one night we were in there, and basically I'd watch them work while I drank their beer, and then later would tell people I was working in there, and I was just like, Hunter, you should just let me borrow these costumes, and I'll do this crazy band. And at the beginning, it wasn't even called Gwar. It was called Gwar! You could go on forever. And we actually would write it on a flyer like that. And it was based on the idea that was the first thing that came out of Gwar's mouth when they woke up. What's the name of the band?
I've always wondered that.
And
that's
we
so
wanted
good
that's
to
serious
make
right
a
there,
movie,
yeah.
Heavy.
But it was just so damn hard to make a movie that we just abandoned it. You know, we like ended up like with these giant like cardboard insides of alien ships, and we were like, okay, we're never gonna do this movie because it's like the script is we can't even. You know, we were just at that point we were starting to become a band and it was starting to blow up. And we were booking tours and we were getting out there, and so we were like, we can't ever make this movie, but we've got to use some part of this whole thing. And we're like, Scumdogs of the Universe. We'll just use the title. We'll never make the damn movie, but let's just use the title. And we used the title, Scumdogs of the Universe, for our first truly awesome album. Yeah. I'll love Hello forever for the punk rock conglomeration of weirdness that it was. But Scumdogs of the Universe with the track Horror of Yig and classics like Maggots and Sick of You. Was the album that will always be the hallmark, I believe, of our careers.
This is really distracting.
He's trying to segue, I'm going.
No, I'm just distracted. But can we just get a look at this real quick?
This is my baby bottle.
Baby's at THOR.
And if you're good, he'll sing you a little song.
Because I'm talking, this face is staring.
I'm Oderus' baby bottle. I'm born without a waddle. A waddle's something a rooster has. I'm really jealous.
Now, that's beautiful.
Very good job.
Now, speaking of killing, in the Gwar shows, you kill people, you kill celebrities.
Certainly, and they deserve it.
Yes. So, is there a signature song where you always kill someone? You have a killing song?
Killing song? Well, yeah. Let Us Slay is a great killing song.
Thank you.
I'm playing a couple sections from a song called 9909, an original composition from Veritas, the album by Alex Sklonick Trio. I'm playing through this Buddha. To get this sound, I'm using channel 1, that's the clean channel, as opposed to channel 2, which is more classic rock, and channel 3, which is more metal. On channel 1, I have most of the tone controls in the center. So you can see the treble, mid, bass, resonance, presence. It's all pretty close to the top. Some of these are turned to the right a little bit. I have a pretty even balance between the volume and the gain. The gain is turned a little bit higher. The overboost is off. No reverb on that one, just pretty much playing dry. And I've got the master volume set at about 11 o'clock. And there are no other effects, so everything else you hear is all found right here in this great amplifier. To get this tone, use a high-end tube guitar amp, such as this Buddha here, or use a modeling amp, such as the Peavey Viper series. To find out more about the Viper series, go to peavey.com.
You back there, the hairy one.
Oderus, how did your parents meet?
They did not meet. My mother was a petri dish. My father was a supercomputer. The seed was born across several light years and brought to, I say her, loosely. The rest was awful. Apparently she had some kind of vulva, some kind of cocoon that I was inside. I was birthed onto stage immediately into a gladiatorial ring. Where unfortunately, and was raped at birth, yes, on intergalactic television.
Earmuffs.
By a giant clown. Then they put a sword in my hand and shoved me into an arena with a minotaur. From the storm!
What's your favorite Gwar song?
The last one in the set. No, yeah, really, yeah, the last one in the set, definitely, because I know I can get the hell out of there. I'd have to go back to Sick of You, because that's the song that's kind of become, that's our signature tune. And when we play Sick of You, I just watch the crowd go crazy. We got no time for your crystal price. We're in a burn out for your advice. Say it to lie, lie, lie. I don't believe it's all the
same. What's your opinion on Dave Mustaine?
You know what? I think I have
provocative question. Yeah. We might have to kill you.
Honestly, yeah. And this is something I've kind of wanted to say to the metal community. I actually have nothing but respect and admiration for Dave Mustaine. They caught me at the tail end of an interview that I've done like 8 interviews in a row. And yeah, I do not agree with Dave Mustaine's political views. I when he sits there and talks about how great Mitt Romney is, I get pissed off. Metal music shouldn't, I mean, for me, is about rebellion. And it's not about the Republicans. You know, I lived through Reagan and Bush, and I know how horrible those years were. You don't want to go back to that. And to hear one of my favorite guitar players babbling on like that, I felt a need to correct him.
Oh, yeah.
Then a lot of other just nastiness came out of my mouth that I did not mean to. And, you know, you got maybe some of you Oderus admirers out there are going to be, don't say that, Oderus. But it's true, I didn't mean to tear him a new one as far as his personal faith. You know, he's allowed to worship Christ, and he, all power to him. You know, I kind of felt bad about it. I thought I really kind of reamed him a new one that was a little bit too raw. And I'm looking forward to seeing him so I can not apologize, but just let him know that I do appreciate what he's done, you know. But you know, one thing I will say, and is this? Tell me if this isn't true or not. Since I said that shit about Mustaine, has he really said anything else?
He's kept quiet.
Yeah.
He knows.
I think. All right.
Down! Burn your heart!
What just happened?
What is there to say?
Yeah.
Wow. What is there to say, people? Can somebody...
That was amazing. That was amazing. You guys sounded great. I had a great time.
You guys sounded awesome. Oderus was just beyond himself to have played the preacher with you and the kids, and said the playing was just awesome. He said that preacher made his life being able to play. So, you know, it's
crazy. I'm honored. It's like,
you know, it's these moments that make all of, you know, that put life together. We can tour, we can rock, we can rehearse, we can, you know, make up, we can break up.
At the end, all you've got are the moments. Really.
Right.
That's what really what it comes down to. And those are great moments. And who would ever imagine back in the day we'd be sitting here with this creature.
Right.
Talking about, you know, rotary phones and pre-internet. Yeah.
Right.
We have reached the end of the season. This has been a blast.
We
had no idea what was going to happen. We just knew... We had this idea. We want to have some kind of a format where it's sort of a talk show, sort of an educational show, sort of an entertainment show. Thanks to the Metal Injection team for helping make this happen. Thanks, everybody, for watching, and we hope you've enjoyed it as much as we have.
Yeah, thanks, and keep it loud. I'm not done.